Tonight's telecast between Pittsburgh and Notre Dame can be seen on ESPN HD, presented by Olivia. We welcome you to South Bend, Indiana, where Notre Dame is riding a 34-game home court winning streak. The Irish, led by Luke Herangode, the front runner for Big East Player of the Year honors. But they'll be challenged tonight by a Panther team hungry for a win. Welcome to Thursday Night Showcase, presented by T. Rowe Price. Notre Dame puts its 34-game home win streak on the line against Pittsburgh, which has won two straight here at the Joy Center. The Irish are 9-3 in conference play heading into tonight, good for fourth place, but they're tied in the loss column with Georgetown, Louisville, and Connecticut. Pittsburgh in seventh place with a record of 7-5 in league play. Hi, everybody. Alongside Len Elmore, I'm Dave Pasch. Where is Pittsburgh right now? Lenny, a week ago against Marquette, they get LeVance Fields back, but they lose by 18, their worst loss in the Jamie Dixon era in Big East play.
Well, Pittsburgh has weathered the injury storm nicely, and with 19 wins, 7-5 in the conference, an RPI of 21, they should be in the NCAA tournament, but they can't relax. Their defense remains solid, but they need another score. Against Marquette, Sam Young was the only person in double figures.
We know where Notre Dame is, playing better on the road and obviously very good at home, having won 34 straight here, and they've got maybe the best player in the conference in Luke Herangode.
Well, Luke Herangode is the Big East Player of the Year in my mind, and the 6'8 sophomore has a variety of skills that he's developed, range from 15 to 18 feet. In the low block, he's able to use his muscle and his perseverance and will down low to score, and certainly a lot quicker because of an off-season conditioning program. He's able to beat people off the bounce.
And he's featured in our Bass Pro Shop Star Watch along with DeJuan Blair of Pittsburgh.
Well, DeJuan Blair, the Rookie of the Year candidate, his best games were against quality opponents. He's got to accept the challenge today against Luke Herangode.
Take a look at the starting lineups for tonight's game for the Panthers. You'll see a lot of LeVance Fields, but he won't start. Ramon, Benjamin, Brown, Sam Young, a candidate for most improved player in the Big East, along with DeJuan Blair. And for the Irish, Torrey Jackson playing his best basketball of late. Kyle McElhinney, Hillis Lynn, Herangode, and the only senior on the Notre Dame roster, Rob Kurz. Notre Dame has won 34 straight here at home. Memphis will put the nation's longest home win streak on the line Saturday night, 9 o'clock on ESPN, when Memphis takes on Tennessee. 1-2. Right now we got the 21st-ranked team in the country, the Fighting Irish, against Pittsburgh, which is unranked for the first time in over 2 years.
And Notre Dame kind of matching up right now. Look down low. Torrey Jackson gets caught against DeJuan Blair inside.
Herangode knocks it out of bounds. It'll stay Pittsburgh ball.
You got to expect a well-played game with these two teams. Notre Dame second, Pittsburgh third in assist turnover margin. Both distribute the ball very well, and they don't turn it over that often.
But Pittsburgh turns it over there off the inbound pass. Jamie Dixon in his fifth year. And assuming that Pittsburgh gets a 20th win, whether tonight or some other time, he'll be the first Pitt coach with five consecutive 20-win seasons.
When you look at Pittsburgh, their staple is man-to-man defense.
Herangode posting up with Blair on him. Now Jackson into the lane. Rob Kurz with the first point of the contest, averaging 12 points per game on the season. He's coming off a big game, 11 points and 14 rebounds in a win at Rutgers last weekend. Here's Sam Young from outside, a three for Young. Third in the Big East in scoring, coming into tonight at 18 points per game.
Well, the kind of pace Pittsburgh wants to play, they don't mind playing in the 60s. They're a half-court team, Notre Dame leading as far as points scored in the Big East. They want to get up and down.
Look at Torrey Jackson on the boards. He's 5'11", and he averages 5 rebounds per game. He had 8 rebounds to go along with 10 assists and 17 points in his last game against Rutgers.
Well, he's the heart of this basketball team, Notre Dame. I mean, he's a guy that's improved greatly, not only shooting from beyond the arc, but from the free throw line. But at 5'10", as you mentioned, just a tremendous rebounder. doesn't mind mixing it up.
You know, and one of the things that Mike Gray says that's different about this basketball team compared to some of his other teams is the toughness of guys like Heron, Godey, and Jackson and what they bring to the table as Blair scores. And then on the other end, comes up with a huge block on Hillisland.
And you don't know how huge that block was. Not only prevented the dunk, but it was excellent timing, avoided a foul. And you're going to see that battle all evening. Blair with a little bit of a dip of the shoulder to get Heron Godey off him, create room for that shot. Both of these guys, big bodies, love to battle inside.
Heron Godey with his first basket of the game. He leads the Big East in scoring and rebounding in conference games.
Well, the key for both of those guys is to be able to contain the other and not get into foul trouble. A lot of easy fun.
Be a fun matchup to watch all night. Heron Godey and Blair.
And Notre Dame again in kind of a matchup zone.
Sam Young's shot spins out, pulled down by Heron Godey. Notre Dame looking to push the tempo. They lead the Big East in scoring. Missed by Hillisland, and now Pittsburgh with numbers.
Hillisland very assertive going to the basket. That's something new. Again, you take a look. Outside at the point of attack is Hillisland.
Here's Ramon for three. Pittsburgh the other day in a loss to Marquette was 1 of 11 from behind the arc. Young with a made three for Pittsburgh and then the miss there by Ramon. Hillisland with the extra pass to Kurz. And some contact as Heron Godey collides with Young, but no call. And Pittsburgh looking to run. Blair, good position, but Jackson with a huge block. How about him getting up there? And McElarney, a deep three, won't go. Out of bounds, last touch by Gilbert Brown of Pittsburgh.
Well, it just shows you Torrey Jackson dangerous on every part of the court. Nobody calls the help. Jackson just peels down from the top. And look at the elevation on that. You know that Dwan Blair, even at 6'7", has a 7'2 wingspan. So you know Jackson had to get up to get that one.
Wide open three by Rob Kurz. He's got 5 of the 9 Fighting Irish points.
And again, as Pittsburgh is most comfortable walking it up, trying to get into a half-court game, forcing Notre Dame to try to play some defense. And again, Hillisland at the top, kind of a triangle and two almost that they're playing. A lot of switching going on down low.
Last touch by Jackson. It will stay Pittsburgh basketball. Torrey Jackson making his presence felt. Just look and listen to the block.
And Cisco, welcome to the Human Network.
Back in South Bend, where Notre Dame has an early lead thanks to 7 second-chance points. The Irish ranked 21st in the country, but they're not the only team from the state of Indiana in the top 25. Been a good year for number 15 Purdue so far. And how about South Bend's own Ryan Newman? Although he went to Purdue, he won the Daytona 500, so they still like him here.
You take a look at Butler and the resurgence of Purdue and their program. Start thinking a little Hoosiers.
And speaking of the Hoosiers.
And not just Indiana Hoosiers, but the state of Indiana Hoosiers.
Benjamin's three and air ball. Speaking of the Hoosiers and all the rumors swirling around Kelvin Sampson, there were some media reports today as Benjamin scores. Kelvin Sampson would be fired, but Andy Katz of ESPN reports that's not true. In fact, according to ESPN.com, Sampson can't be fired outright because it's not allowed on his contract. They either have to suspend him without pay or allow him to continue to coach, and we should find out which option will be used by Indiana tomorrow.
Well, I can tell you this. After this debacle, there won't be a contract signed again where a coach can't be fired outright for violations of NCAA rules if, in fact, Kelvin Sampson did violate those rules.
And, of course, Indiana has to be careful after what took place with Ohio State and Jim O'Brien. O'Brien coming back to sue Ohio State and Ohio State having to pay him some $2.5 million.
And it's all in the art of the contract, all in the art of drafting.
something you used to do as a player agent. As Notre Dame turns it over, Hillis Lane couldn't save it on the baseline. Well, it has been a tumultuous last 3 years for Kelvin Sampson, starting when he was at Oklahoma. And then most recently, the five allegations listed by the NCAA.
See, the problem I have is that if Indiana does its internal investigation and allows Kelvin Sampson to answer, and they find that he did violate those allegations, they've hamstrung themselves by not having a clause that allows the termination with cause. And I just don't understand. I mean, I love the game of basketball. I know how important basketball coaches are, but how can you allow this type of situation, this albatross to hang around your neck, that you can't fire a coach for violating NCAA rules?
Shot clock at 7 for Benjamin, and Keith Benjamin starting to catch fire. He's out there right now with LaVance Fields, and Benjamin's the guy that stepped in when Fields was hurt, played pretty well. Averaged 12 points per game during the absence of Fields, who missed 12 games with a foot injury, as Rob Kurz gets another basket. He's got 7 of the 11 Notre Dame points.
Again, you talk about Keith Benjamin, and he had a stretch when he first took over and got into the starting lineup of 6 consecutive double-figure games and averaged 16 points during that game. What a lift for Pittsburgh at a time when they were really down. They lost Mike Cook and then LaVance Fields. And that's why they've weathered this injury storm pretty nicely.
Ed Fields is their leading assist man at 5 per game and averages 11 points per game. Ramon's shot won't fall. Blair trying to keep it alive, and McElarney out of there with it for Notre Dame. Here's Ayers in transition. His 3 off the mark. Torrey Jackson with the putback from outside. He's got 4. And a timeout by Pittsburgh. Irish by 4, trying to extend their home winning streak to 35 straight. Back in South Bend, Luke Herangode might be the player of the year in the Big East, but Torrey Jackson is as valuable as Herangode to this Notre Dame basketball team.
Well, he's so athletic. A lot of people don't realize how athletic he is, but just a tremendous rebounder. We talked about it before at 5'10". And the reason for that timeout, Jamie Dixon not happy with the fact Notre Dame, 5 offensive rebounds, 9 points off those second chances. This team has got to find a way to keep Notre Dame off the glass on the offensive end.
In Jackson's last game against Rutgers, he was 2 rebounds shy of a triple-double already. Has 5 of the 10 Notre Dame rebounds to go along with 3 assists and 4 points. And we've only played 7 minutes. Young with a turnaround. Not there. And another rebound for Jackson. And taking it from one end to the other for another basket. He's got 6 points now.
Things starting to kind of fall apart a little bit for Pittsburgh. Defensively, not getting back. And not even stopping the ball, which is the first rule in a transition situation. Stop the ball, allow the defense to get back.
Ramon off target with another 3-point try. He's 0-for-3 from out there. Notre Dame again in transition, and an offensive foul is called on Kurz. That's the first foul called on either team tonight.
And Kurz kind of disappointed in the call because he took great pains to try to stop himself. Watch right there. Tries to hold up. But it kind of dips his shoulder, and I think that's what keys the official. Right there, tries to get under control. Nice job by Fields to, you know, get the official's attention with a bit of an act. Take a look at the pressure here, trying to slow Pittsburgh down a bit, but I don't know why. Pittsburgh doesn't want to necessarily run unless they have numbers. Notre Dame changing defenses, still staying in kind of a zone. It looks almost like a boxing one or a diamond in one. Sam Young, the one guy that's getting guarded man-to-man.
Shot clock at 6 now for Pittsburgh. And Fields' 3 is good. Only 29% from out there. But LaVance Fields so important to the Panthers and making his presence felt here in the first half on the road.
And again, I think the defense of Notre Dame goes back to the fact that against Marquette, Sam Young 18 points, nobody else in double figures, 1 of 11 from beyond the arc. So Mike Bray really trying to test Pittsburgh's ability to score beyond Young.
Zeller's 3 won't go. Fields with the rebound. Pittsburgh within 3. Looking to cut the lead to 1 and maybe tie it on this possession. Fields slips and falls, but somehow it ends up in the hands of Biggs. He couldn't make it, but Fields the rebound. Young missing the three. Another chance for Pittsburgh. Wanamaker fouled by Ayers, and he'll go to the line for two. First foul on Ayers, second on Notre Dame. Now the countdown to number one continues. The IBM Top 25, more when we come back.
IBM presents the 25 greatest players ever. Number 12, Christian Laettner. Christian Laettner laid the groundwork for the power program that is Duke University. Four Final Fours, two national championships, and one turnaround jumper that will never be forgotten. IBM, getting it done.
Well, Christian Laettner, one of the best college players that we've seen in the last 20 years, led Duke to a pair of national titles, was player of the year in 92, and is the all-time leading scorer in the history of the NCAA tournament.
Well, richly deserved for his time in college basketball. You're talking about a turnaround jump shot that will never be forgotten. Rick Pitino won't forget it.
Yeah.
And for reasons, no better reason than maybe I should have put a guy on the ball. I never could have gotten that pass to him. But still a tremendous accomplishment over a four-year period for Christian Laettner.
Brad Wanamaker hits the first free throw. Now people are going to look at this list as we talk about the last five in the top 25, counting down the number one, and say, what is Laettner doing ahead of Jordan, Magic, and Patrick Ewing? But remember, this is college, not the entire body of work, including professional basketball.
And also the disclaimer is I didn't make that choice. Somebody else did.
We'll count down the top 25 every night of college basketball and announce number one during the Carolina-Duke game March 8th. Even so, it does seem a little high for Laettner at number 12, doesn't it?
Well, I mean, I don't know. You listen to the accomplishments and the awards that he's garnered. I think Christian Laettner is very deserving. But, you know, you could switch those guys around and still get no arguments from me.
And again, if he had gone on to have a better pro career, then maybe we wouldn't be saying that. And it's, again, based entirely on what you did in college. Here's Zeller's three. Aaron Godey kept it alive, but then pulled down by Biggs. Here's LaVance Fields. Got a three already tonight. Can't get the bounce there. Aaron Godey rebounds. He leads the Big East in conference games in that category, and he's got three tonight. Torrey Jackson, the smallest guy on the floor, already has seven rebounds as McElarney gets inside for the basket. And that's his first hoop tonight.
Notre Dame continues to attack now in transition. You're not backing it out. They continue to find ways to penetrate, need a kick, and you saw McElarney with that little runner.
Notre Dame at 9-3 in the Big East. They are fourth in the conference, but they're tied with Georgetown, Louisville, and Connecticut in terms of losses. All of them have three conference losses. Notre Dame has not lost at home this year. In fact, has won 34 straight here at the Choice Center as DeJuan Blair connects from about 12 feet, and he's got four.
And even in their man-to-man, which usually Notre Dame has played in this game in the case of transition, they're backing off of guys, making them prove that they can shoot it. And that time, DeJuan Blair had plenty of room.
Three rebounds, 4 points for Blair, who had just 6 points and five rebounds against Marquette on Friday night. Aaron Godey with his second basket, 4 points, three rebounds for him.
Quick move by Aaron Godey, but too easy on the baseline as Blair just let him go. Got to force guys to the help, particularly a scorer of the dimension of Aaron Godey.
Benjamin with a brick, and Aaron Godey gets to the loose ball. Jonathan Peoples off the bench knocks down Notre Dame's second three of the game.
And that shot made Wanamaker start talking to himself and won Jamie Dixon to talk to his team. Peoples, a guy very capable from beyond the arc. That time about 3 feet from beyond the arc with Wanamaker's hand in his face, and Wanamaker just shook his head.
Peoples shoots 36% from out there. Saturday primetime on ESPN means college basketball number one and number two in our Saturday primetime game presented by DirecTV. Memphis and Tennessee. Memphis has won 44 consecutive regular season games, 26-0 this year. And Tennessee having a terrific season so far at 24-2. What do you think here, Lambert? In this matchup, last year you had Ohio State-Wisconsin go ahead-to-head. Won a great game. Ohio State beat Wisconsin by one. You'd think this would be a little bit higher scoring between Tennessee and Memphis, right?
Oh, they'll get up and down. They'll create some turnovers. You see a lot of stuff in transition. Terrific matchups. Tyler Smith for Tennessee just doing a tremendous job. I mean, Chris Lofton gets a lot of the pub, but Smith getting the job done. And, of course, we know about Douglas Roberts, Derrick Rose, and company.
Benjamin with the jumper right out of the timeout. He's got 7 points now to lead all Panther scorers. Pittsburgh's already used up 2 timeouts.
And look again, Notre Dame looking to penetrate and kick, recognizing Pittsburgh, a terrific defensive team, particularly if you're stationary. That time, Blair does a nice job of holding his ground with that big body, keeping Herringote from getting in the paint.
Benjamin's 3, no. Blair tried to tip it in, and then Kurz clears for Notre Dame. Peoples driving to the basket. Offensive foul is called on Peoples. That's his first and the third on Notre Dame. Still no team fouls on Pittsburgh. Panthers trail by 4 in South Bend. Well, you saw the note there on Randy Moss and Charlie Weiss's former team, the New England Patriots. There's Charlie with John Tenuta, who's been hired away from Georgia Tech. And Weiss, in the offseason, after talking with Bill Belichick, the Patriots head coach, giving up play calling duty. Mike Haywood will call the plays next year for Notre Dame after a 3-9 season. Tenuta brought over from Georgia Tech to help shore up things on the defensive side of the ball.
Well, Dave, you brought up the point before the break that Pittsburgh has no team fouls, 0 personal fouls, obviously, and Notre Dame only 3. But we said this was going to be a well-played game. These two teams rarely hurt themselves. Second and third, respectively, Notre Dame and Pittsburgh in assist turnover margin. Pittsburgh actually came into this game with 46 fewer personal fouls than opponents.
Brown with a great follow after the missed 3. Pittsburgh just 3 of 11 from behind the arc and 30% overall, while Notre Dame shooting 50%. Yet it's only a 2-point game with 7 minutes remaining in the first half. Jackson for 3. And Blair with the rebound for the Panthers.
And again, when you play defense the way Pittsburgh does and have come into this game 46 fewer personal fouls, you're getting the job done defensively.
Quick timeout by Notre Dame after Young hits the 3 to give Pittsburgh the lead.
Well, one of the rules is you always block out the shooter. And when you have a shooter right here, you're going to see the shot taken off the penetration and the kick. And that's what happens. Hillisland runs by him instead of turns and blocks him out. Shooter always knows where the ball's going. If you're missing it, they know exactly where they need to be.
And since that Jamie Dixon timeout, Pittsburgh has scored 8 in a row to take a 1-point lead. College basketball continues on ABC Saturday afternoon with regional coverage. You'll either see Oklahoma and number 7 Texas or Oregon and UCLA. College basketball presented by KFC on ABC. Some think it's the Big East, Len. Some say the Pac-10 is the best conference in college basketball. What do you say?
Well, I mean, if you're talking top to bottom, I think the Big East is the most competitive conference because just about any of the teams, save the bottom two, South Florida and Rutgers, who have demonstrated they've been competitive. Rutgers actually went in the pit and beat Pittsburgh at home. But I think that any of those teams of the top teams in the conference are capable of beating somebody on a given night. And I think the Pac-10 has that kind of depth as well. But if you're talking about the top teams and you look at wins and the head-to-head bases and such, I think there's enough information out there to support the ACC being the toughest conference.
Well, I think the fact that Duke is playing as well as it had been for a couple months and then losing to Wake Forest and Miami speaks to that, doesn't it, as Blair gets a basket inside for Pitt.
Actually, all it means is if you squeeze the numbers hard enough, they'll tell you anything they want. Anything you want them to tell you.
Herringote. That rattles out. Young with a rebound. 25-24 Pittsburgh. This is rare for a road team to be leading at Notre Dame, where the Irish have won 34 straight. Nice play defensively by Jackson, and then a foul by Fields. And both players slow to get up. That's only the first foul on Pittsburgh as a team.
We talked about the battle down low between Harangody and Blair, and you see Blair's foot quickness trying to get out, bother Harangody, but it really got him out of position, and Harangody, a nice job of locating, feeling, and putting himself in a position where he can score, and Blair on the other end just gets himself down low and calls for it aggressively. It's going to be a treat to watch these guys because none of them are, neither one of them are traditional big guys that are always down on the block. They'll step outside, hit some jumpers, they'll put the ball on the floor and drive to the basket.
Identical numbers right now for Blair and Harangody. 6 points, 4 rebounds apiece. 10 seconds on the shot clock. Harangody on McGee.
A loose ball, Pittsburgh. Somebody should have gotten on it. Instead, Notre Dame comes up with it.
That did hit the rim, so a new shot clock for Notre Dame. Ayers pulling the trigger, short with a three. Look at Harangody battle, trying to keep it alive, just throwing his body around, but Pittsburgh comes up with the ball.
And the crowd is booing because they thought Ryan Ayers was fouled, but that was kind of a flop by Ryan Ayers, looking to try to draw the foul. No contact made. And one thing in favor, at least in the advantage of the big man inside, is that Pitt has a guy like Gary McGee, the big freshman, able to come in and eat some minutes, put a body on Harangody and wear him down a little bit.
Zach Hillisland called for the foul, his first and the fourth on Notre Dame. Harangody and Blair, as we mentioned, with identical numbers so far. Harangody recently named the midseason Wooden and Naismith top 30 award candidate, and he wasn't even a preseason mention. Remember, he had that thumb injury in the preseason. They thought that Harangody might miss a month or 6 weeks, but he didn't miss any time at all. Here come the Irish after the block. McElarney spotting up. Harangody with the follow.
Well, Notre Dame, first in rebound margin and offensive rebounding in the Big East. Just keeping up with their numbers, doing a tremendous job on the offensive glass.
Brown scoring, and Pittsburgh back up one, 4 points for Brown.
And we talked about Pittsburgh needing another score beyond Sam Young, and they're starting to get some balance in their scoring. Young, Blair, Benjamin, all chipping in.
Harangody fouled by McGee. Only the second team foul on Pittsburgh and the first on McGee.
Well, talking about Notre Dame matching Pittsburgh inside and in transition. Not too many teams better on the offensive glass.
Sean Miller, the head coach at Xavier. He's a former Pitt Panther guard, and you would think that his alma mater would be in the NCAA tournament, regardless of how they finish with wins against Duke and Georgetown. RPI at 21, Len.
Oh, yeah, I think that this is a team that obviously has earned their way in. The wins against Duke and Georgetown certainly have taken them a long way. And when you look at their schedule, you figure that based upon the teams that they have to play and where they have to play them, that even if they finish at 9-9 in a very competitive conference, that they're not going to have a problem. But, you know, you can't relax. And as I mentioned at the beginning of the telecast, what they need to do if they continue to climb, find other guys who can put the ball in the basket besides Sam Young, because as Notre Dame is trying to do with their variety of defenses, they're trying to take Sam Young out of the ball game and force other guys to beat him.
Harangody with the free throws. Pittsburgh has made 6 straight trips to the NCAA tournament, one of only 12 schools to accomplish that feat, and the only Big East school in the NCAAs each in the last 6 years. Steal by Ayers, but then gave it right back to Fields.
Nice.
And Blair down low missed the layup. Harangody with the board. 6 rebounds for Harangody. McElarney on the other end. Unable to drop in the three, and Young gets the board for Pittsburgh, and now Fields in the front court. McElarney 0 for 3 from behind the arc. 2 points in the game. He's the second leading scorer for Notre Dame. Gilbert Brown able to get that one to go. He's got 6.
Brown with a nice job just reading the defense, getting into the gap, and pulling up for the mid-range shot. Not done nearly enough. And the quick feed by Dwan Blair almost got that one stolen. Leads his team in assists. in steals. And one of the top guys in steals in the conference.
Aaron Doty, no. Young with the rebound. Ramon from the corner.
Pittsburgh a little confused right now offensively, although that didn't look very confusing.
And then Hillisland called for a foul. That's his second.
Pittsburgh's got to solve the spacing problem. But right here, Brown does a nice job. Sees the gap and gets right into where the elbow is and able to hit the shot. And down low, Blair with a nice job of pushing Heron Goody way outside of his comfort zone on the block, forcing Heron Goody with a fallaway shot.
See the numbers on Tawan Blair. Having a fine freshman season. Couldn't hit the first free throw, though. The NBA on ESPN continues with a doubleheader tomorrow night, starting with the Wizards and the new-look Cavs, with Ben Wallace coming over in a trade today to Cleveland, followed by the Celtics and the Suns. Get our first look at Shaquille O'Neal last night in a Suns uniform. Phoenix losing at home to the Lakers, who might be the best team in the West right now. Minutes remaining here in the first half. Pittsburgh leading Notre Dame by one. Blair unable to get either free throw. Haven't had a lot of stoppages. Only been about a 35-minute half. Seven combined turnovers and only seven total fouls in this game.
I told you it's going to be a well-played game. I mean, these two teams don't hurt each other. Don't hurt themselves very often.
They're trying to hurt each other. Aaron Doty and Blair, you know, both those guys putting a hurting on one another as LaVance Fields drives to the basket, scores, and is fouled.
Well, if you had any doubts about LaVance Fields, whether or not he's back, 20 minutes against Marquette, probably got him back in form, and there on the drive, just got head and shoulders past McElarney to the frustration of Heron Goody not stepping up to help. And this guy's so important because what he brings is not only the ability to score, again, taking the pressure off of Sam Young, but his ability to create for others. And you got to respect that, particularly when he's beating you off the bounce.
You know, we were talking about Sean Miller before. Fields is number one all-time in Pittsburgh history in assist-to-turnover ratio. Sean Miller was number two, and you think of just how good of a ball handler Sean Miller was. Remember those the shots we had of him on the Johnny Carson show with the ball handling, him and his brother. Well, Fields is actually better in terms of assist-to-turnover ratio at Pittsburgh. And just the fact that he's on the floor, you know, is helping Pittsburgh tonight as Jackson is fouled on his way to the basket. Sam Young picks up his first and the third on Pittsburgh.
And the crowd with kind of a derisive cheer, recognizing the discrepancy in team fouls.
Actually, they get Ramon there instead of Young. Peoples and Ayers go to the bench. Gordon, Notre Dame. Here's McElarney over Ramon. And Young with the rebound is fifth.
And Pittsburgh's doing a nice job keeping Kyle McElarney in check. McElarney averaging 15 points a game, only 2 points thus far.
Young got it blocked by Kurz. It's a 17-6 run for Pittsburgh. Remember, Notre Dame's won 34 straight here at home, but Pittsburgh's had its number the last 5 years, winning five in a row and two straight here over Notre Dame at the Joyce Center. McElarney's three, no. Heron Goody with the rebound. No, but he'll go to the line for two. Again, Notre Dame getting it done on the offensive glass.
Well, we mentioned it before. They lead in conference games. They lead the conference in offensive rebounding. You take a look again. McElarney misfires. It is Heron Goody with that perseverance, creating the contact. Pittsburgh not very happy, believing that Terrell Biggs was just standing there with his hands up.
Biggs picks up his first. Heron Goody, he's got 10 points, 9 rebounds, so he's going to get another double-double. But he had 6 straight prior to their game against Rutgers when he was held to 10 points and 8 rebounds.
But you can see the frustration of Jamie Dixon off of that last sequence we saw in the replay. No real blockouts. Guys standing around but not putting bodies on people, allowing Notre Dame to be aggressive on the offensive glass.
About a 9-second difference between the game and shot clocks. LaVance Fields with the basketball. 6 points, 2 assists, 3 rebounds. His second game back after missing 12 in a row with a foot injury.
Got a good look now at Notre Dame dropping back into a 2-3 zone.
Benjamin was left open. Cans a three. He's got 10 points to lead Pittsburgh in scoring. 5 seconds to go in the half. Jackson trying to answer. Can't hit the three. And that will end the half. How about this? Pittsburgh, which has won two straight in South Bend, trying to end Notre Dame's 34-game home win streak. 6 points, five rebounds for Blair, 12 points, nine boards for Heron Godey. Time for the UPS halftime report, and Scott Reese. Wins 15 in a row against Big East teams, but that's in jeopardy right now on Thursday Night Showcase presented by T. Rowe Price. Pittsburgh leads Notre Dame by 5. Back with Len Elmore, I'm Dave Pasch. Jamie Dixon called timeout when it was 22-15. Notre Dame leading. Since then, Pittsburgh is plus 12. What changed?
Well, I think it's really the focus on keeping Notre Dame off the board, but at the beginning of the telecast, we told you that for Pittsburgh to climb, their defense needs to remain solid, which it certainly has. Luke Arangoti, even though he has 12 points, has kind of been stymied inside because of tremendous defense inside as well as on the perimeter. And Pittsburgh needed someone other than Sam Young to put the ball in the basket, and they've gotten some terrific balance. Gilbert, Brown, Sam Young, Vance Fields, 6 points, great balance right there. Keith Benjamin leads all scorers with 10. So they've gotten that balance on the offensive end. Now Notre Dame, you know, they've got to be able to find a way to get some people some good looks from beyond the arc. Just 2 of 11 from three, and they rely on the three ball. They make about 8 a game. And Kyle McElarney in particular, 1 of 6 from the field, 0 of 4 from beyond the arc. Got to get him some better looks.
This is only the second time Notre Dame has trailed at home this season at halftime. The other game was against Cincinnati. They were down 7 at the half and then scored 64 in the second half and beat Cincinnati by 17.
And you saw the quick feet and the long reach of DeJuan Blair once again knocking the ball away from Luke Herangode.
Meanwhile, Ramon continues to struggle. He is scoreless tonight as he misses his fourth three of the game. Aaron Godey led the Irish in scoring with 12. Kurz had 7. McElarney was held to just 2, and he's their second leading scorer at 15 points per game.
And remember, Notre Dame scores about 80 points a game, and Pittsburgh's done a terrific job holding them to just 30 at the half.
Hillis Land with a short jumper. That's his first basket of the contest and the first points of the second half for either team.
And as you see, Pittsburgh walked the ball up. One of the ways they've been able to hold Notre Dame down offensively is to control the tempo.
Blair with good position, and DeJuan Blair with the basket and a Herangode foul. First foul in the half and the first on Herangode tonight.
Well, one of the ways you can slow down a terrific scorer like Herangode is to make him play defense. Little screen across, small on big. Herangode doesn't get there in time.
Aaron Godey, the front runner for Player of the Year. Blair might be the front runner for Rookie of the Year in the Big East Conference. Johnny Flynn and Dante Green, both of Syracuse, were the co-rookies of the year preseason.
And that's going to be quite a battle. And Green and Flynn may ultimately cancel each other out and give Blair an opening as far as the voting is concerned. Third-party candidate, you know?
Now, not many people were talking about Blair before the season as he gets the rebound there off the Herangode miss.
Well, again, Blair using that big body, keeping Herangode away from the basket. And look at this. Forces Herangode under the basket using that swing. Herangode frustrated, screaming at the official.
11 points now for Blair to lead Pittsburgh in scoring tonight. He averages right around 12 points per game. Kurz for three. Notre Dame now 2 of 13 from behind the arc. Torrey Jackson battling among three Panthers, and it goes out of bounds off of Blair.
And we talk about DeJuan Blair. Not only does he have the long reach, but quick feet. And there he just takes position using that body. Herangode loves to feel you before he goes up strong. And Blair playing a little cat and mouse. Feel me and not feel me.
Meanwhile, an offensive foul called on Herangode. That's his second personal, so he'll go to the bench. Second team foul on the Irish in the half.
Take a look at the foul right there. Heron Goedy just dips that shoulder, trying to feel Blair. And Blair, as I said, cat and mouse. He lets him feel him. Sometimes he steps away. That time, Heron Goedy was determined he was going to get to the basket. And Blair, wise beyond his years as a freshman, took the charge.
Blair the other night against Marquette took three charges. Actually hurt his knee in that game, but appears to be okay tonight. And certainly in the second half, he's been terrific. And it's a 10-point lead for Pittsburgh, its largest of the game.
And even though Luke Zeller at 6'11 should have a size advantage over Blair, Blair's reach and his savvy down low makes that a mismatch if Notre Dame's going to continue to play Zeller on Blair.
How will Notre Dame respond here? This is unfamiliar territory at home. Zeller knocks that shot down. It's a two. The Irish have not lost at home since February 25th, 2006.
But they have been down before. We saw them have a 21-point lead against Connecticut. Connecticut comes back and takes a 5-point lead. A lot of teams would have given it up, but Notre Dame persevered. And one thing about this team here in this house, they feel that they don't lose.
Ramon still 0 for the night. 0 for 7 now from the field. Blair got his hand in there and knock it out of bounds. It'll stay Notre Dame basketball. And during this 34-game home winning streak, there was an overtime game this year. Mike Gray's team beating Providence in OT. Memphis right now with the longest home court winning streak. Tigers will play number 2 Tennessee on Saturday night, our primetime game. At 9 Eastern, as Blair has 7 second-half points, and he'll go to the bench for a couple of minutes.
Again, prime opportunity to rest Juan Blair with Luke Heron going on the bench with foul trouble.
The extra pass by Hillis Land, and Kurz buries a three, and Notre Dame scoring 5 straight points to get back within 5.
And we said at the beginning of this half that Notre Dame needed to get better looks from beyond the arc. This is a team that relies on the 3-point shot and make 8 a game.
Young, great move. He missed the dunk, but he was fouled, and he'll go to the line.
Notre Dame, more patient on offense right now. You look at the extra pass, catching Pittsburgh in rotation with the wide look. And then Sam Young, nice ball fake, looking to finish strong and gets fouled.
Zeller picks up his first third-team foul on Notre Dame. Sam Young, 69% free-throw shooter. Last year averaged 7 points, 3 rebounds. This year, averaging 18 points, 7 rebounds per game.
And still the most consistent offensive player on this team. Last two games averaging about 20 points.
Multi-talented young man, plays the piano. He's a gymnast. Says he gets his inspiration from his brother, who is blind but is a world-class wrestler, as McElarney drills a three, and Notre Dame is within 4. Only the second field goal of the game for McElarney.
Well, you don't want McElarney to come out of the bottle and get loose if you're Pittsburgh. They did a good job on him in the first half, but they've got to really tighten up. Because once he gets started, he's a terrific streak shooter.
Maybe not the option there that Jamie Dixon wants. Tyrell Biggs taking a 16-footer. And then Jackson drawing the foul on Benjamin on the other end. First on Benjamin, first on Pittsburgh. Kyle McElarney stepping up. Pittsburgh's lead was 10. Down to 4 after that three by McElarney. Tonight's Pittsburgh Notre Dame telecast on ESPN HD is presented by Olivia. Back in South Bend, where Austin Carr once ruled, and he was honored at halftime after being elected into the College Basketball Hall of Fame. Second all-time in college basketball history, and career scoring average behind Pistol Pete, National Player of the Year in 1971. Very emotional at halftime, says this was the best time of his life being a student athlete here at Notre Dame. Hillis Land fouled on his way to the basket. Gilbert Brown picks up his first second on Pittsburgh. You played against Austin Carr in the pros a little bit, Lenny.
Yeah, Austin Carr was one of those strong guards that could shoot it. Obviously, early in the career, no 3-point shot. Found ways to score, averaging almost 35 points a game with no 3-point line. You can imagine how efficient he was.
Here's a blocking foul. John Cal says no as before the shot as Fields tried to step in. Second personal on Fields, third on fifth.
And you can see right now, Notre Dame, that newfound aggressiveness to the basket. They began the game that way and somehow slowed down as Pittsburgh really started to clamp down. But now not really settling for long jump shots, although right there, Luke Zeller did. That's his shot, though.
He's a 41% three-point shooter. Young tried to avoid charging into Zeller, lost the ball, but it stays with Pittsburgh. And Benjamin cans a three. That's his third triple of the night.
And there was contact on that. Surprised there was no whistle, even though Sam Young lost the ball.
Benjamin averaging 9 points per game, but close to 12 in Big East play. He's got 13 for Pittsburgh in the game, looking for another basket. Now 15 points, and Pittsburgh back up nine.
Well, Keith Benjamin came into this program with a reputation of being an explosive scorer. And really, with the tremendous players that Pittsburgh has had over the years that he's been here, never really had a chance to demonstrate that. And it's only because Mike Cook got hurt and LaVance Fields got hurt that Benjamin's seeing more time. And he's definitely made the most of it.
And Benjamin was hurt himself for a while. In fact, he had 8 stitches in his right hand, and they kept coming apart. Kept opening up during games, but he played through it. Over the head of Kurz, trying to track it down and couldn't save it. It'll go to Pittsburgh.
Thought that was a pass to me. I was ready to fire it up. But we go back to Pittsburgh possession where Young loses possession. And there is contact. And I guess the Irish fans are screaming that it should have been a charge, but there was a lean in. But after getting a rebound, Pittsburgh finds a way to get it back to Benjamin, the hot hand.
Pittsburgh shooting a little bit better from the three-point line tonight than it had been the last couple of weeks. In particular, that game last Friday at Marquette when they went 1 of 11 was their worst Big East loss in the Jamie Dixon era. That was last touched by Notre Dame. Pittsburgh rarely has bad back-to-back games. In fact, only 5 times in Dixon's tenure have they lost consecutive games. As you can see, Jackson did get a finger in there.
And Tim Higgins, the official, right on top of it.
It has won 2 straight here at the Joyce Center. Notre Dame's won 34 in a row at home. Sam Young gives Pittsburgh its largest lead of the night at 11 points.
And Sam Young, he of the old school ball fake, just getting Notre Dame off balance offensively. A nice job there by Jackson to kind of put a finger in the dike.
8 points for Jackson and a timeout by Notre Dame. Pittsburgh leads by 9 in South Bend. Back in a moment. Flying fun on Saturday night is 1-2. Memphis 26-0, taking on 24-2 Tennessee. The number 2 team has won 5 of the last 6 meetings in the 1-versus-2 matchup since 1994.
The 2 teams that like the pressure, get up and down, some terrific matchups. Raymar Smith and Derrick Rose at the point. Chris Lofton, Chris Douglas, Roberts, shooting guard. And Tyler Smith, maybe Joey Dorsey in the middle. I mean, everywhere you look, they're going to be tremendous matchups here. Something's got to give.
Fields on the drive, no. And rebounded by Ayers. We talk about Luke Herangode being the front runner for player of the year in the conference. What about nationally? Does Chris Douglas Roberts deserve some attention there, Len, based on what Memphis has done as a team and he's done individually?
Yeah, I mean, he deserves some mention, but when you look at teams that are in the national spotlight, ranked, and guys who are just so overly dominant, I mean, I guess it's a double-edged sword. Chris Douglas Roberts plays for a team that's very well balanced.
Shot clock at 5. How about the way Hansbrough's playing without Ty Lawson as Herangode is fouled? That's on Sam Young. That's his first, and the fourth on Pittsburgh. Well, let's take a look at the Elmore Index and your leading player of the year candidates.
Well, again, the criteria has a lot to do with possession, with points scored, contributions to team wins, and of course, team wins are a bonus. And Tyler Hansbrough, what a tremendous job he's done with Ty Lawson on the bench. Lawson's loss makes North Carolina a different kind of team. maybe not as dynamic, but Hansbrough has literally taken him, put him on his back. When you talk about the index, I'm talking about, again, giving value to contribution to team wins. And points, obviously, are paramount because you got to outscore the other guy. But when you talk about possessions, rebounds, certainly steals have value. And then assists, being able to work within the team concept. And then you have a bonus for team wins, because none of this means anything if your team's not winning. And that's all subjective criteria, objective criteria, to go along with the subjective. You know, sometimes it becomes too much of a beauty contest. At least with the objective criteria, we know we're in the ballpark with the guys that we've chosen. And Beasley and Hansbrough are definitely the front runners for Player of the Year nationally.
Heron Goody now 5 of 6 at the line, his first point of the second half. Biggs misses. Blair can't tip it in once, twice. Biggs, another chance. No, but he's fouled. Ayers picking up the personal, his second, and the fourth on Notre Dame here in the half.
And Jamie Dixon begging the official, John Cowell, for a goaltend, or I'm sorry, a basket interference, but there doesn't seem to be any contact on that one.
Jamie Dixon has maybe done his best coaching job this year, considering Mike Cook tore his ACL against Duke. LaVance Fields missed 12 games of the foot injury. A couple other guys that may have contributed. Cassin Diggs, who's actually available, been out with a hip injury, and Austin Wallace with a knee injury out for the season. But they're going to get their 20th win, whether it's tonight, Len, or elsewhere down the road. It's a great job by Dixon, considering all the injuries. And for a while, they're only having 8 healthy scholarship players.
Well, the one thing that Jamie Dixon never veered from was his focus on defense. And defense is an absolute constant. And when you look at this team, that's what they're built on. That's what they continue to focus on. Even when they had difficulty scoring, they were in a lot of games because of the defense. And now that they've got some scoring back, some balance, much better at it. Although right there, Luke Herangode's starting to feel his oats again.
Now, on the other side, Mike Gray was the coach of the year in the Big East last year, and you can make a case for him this year as well. And Notre Dame, considering it lost its top two scorers from a year ago, was picked to do well, but not this well. Right now being tied in the loss column at Georgetown, Louisville, and UConn. Blair fouled by Kurz after getting the rebound. The fans don't like it here. They're down 8 at home. Notre Dame's 34-game home win streak on the line right now, trailing by 8 to Pittsburgh. DeJuan Blair has been the story in the second half of the Panthers, who lead with 11:42 to go.
Well, he's been the story on both ends. Really got off to a good start in the second half, getting inside. And here, offensive rebounding, really making his presence known. And then defensively, kind of frustrating Luke Herangode. Although Herangode with 15 points, 9 rebounds, DeJuan Blair has pretty much matched that. He's got a double-double going right now.
DeJuan Blair from Pittsburgh. In fact, his house that he grew up in, about a couple of Len Elmore three irons, 600 yards away from the Peterson Event Center.
Yeah, obviously haven't seen you play golf. And you talk about building a house. DeJuan Blair doesn't want to build a house here with bricks on the free throw line.
It's just 1 of 5 now at the foul line in the game. And who knows, that might cost Pittsburgh in the end, as Hillisland gets a layup and the Irish down 6.
Tremendous continuity. And just a nice job again of getting people moving without the ball in Notre Dame on their last possession.
Been 2 years since Notre Dame last lost at home. Pittsburgh has won 2 in a row here at the Joyce Center. As Blair gets called for the foul, that's only his first personal and the 5th on Pitt.
Well, again, you don't want silly fouls. DeJuan Blair's got to know better right now. You know, this is a game where every one of those is going to count if they contribute towards getting to the free throw line. And the longer you can keep Notre Dame off the free throw line, the better. Tremendous free throw shooting team at 74%.
Kurz back door for the layup. Both he and McElarney were open. And Kurz takes it, and Notre Dame is only down 4, forcing Pitt to call timeout.
Well, again, Notre Dame just continues to spread the floor. And Pittsburgh turning their heads defensively. And you're just going to take a look right here. After setting the screen, he's going to step here and then go back door to the basket. And really, all it is the guy who sets the screen is usually the guy that's open because the man guarding the screener is helping and leaves his man wide open.
College basketball continues Saturday afternoon on ABC with regional coverage featuring number 7 Texas against Oklahoma or Oregon UCLA. College basketball presented by KFC on ABC at 3:30 Eastern Saturday. Texas right now tied with Kansas for the Big 12 lead. Pittsburgh right now in 7th place in the Big East. Notre Dame in 4th place, but tied with Georgetown, Louisville, and Connecticut in the loss column. Plus, the Irish have won 34 straight home games. Third longest active home winning streak in college basketball. And the third longest ever in the Big East. Pittsburgh holds the longest home win streak in Big East play with 20 straight earlier this decade. Sam Young for 3, no. And Blair tangled up with Kerr's, and Kerr's going to get called for the foul. That's his third and the 6th on Notre Dame in the half.
But one thing you can count on is DeJuan Blair. Something's going on underneath the basket. Usually he's going to be involved. Notre Dame doing everything they can to keep him off the offensive glass, including trying to hold him down.
Benjamin, short with a 3. He does have 15 points to lead Pittsburgh. Aaron Godey down low. Tried to muscle it up and in twice and couldn't get either one to go. And now Ramon out of there with it for the Panthers.
One thing you can say about DeJuan Blair, he's learning early in the game. Aaron Godey getting the baseline all too easily. Blair doing a nice job with his body. And there's Sam Young with that old school ball fake. Just raises his arm straight up in the air. And Notre Dame bites just about every time.
Nice left hand too for Young, who's got 12 points. He was the only Pitt player in double figures in a loss at Marquette last Friday. Scored 18 in that game. Pittsburgh by 6. Now a Panther foul. That'll be the 6th team foul.
And again, watch the old school ball fake. Straight up in the air. Obviously, his man bites, Kurz bites, and then Young, much improved off the bounce, takes it to the basket. As you mentioned, Dave, using that left.
Second personal on Benjamin. Look at the rebound, again, by Torrey Jackson, giving Kurz a second chance opportunity. Jackson again, and he'll go to the line. This kid's incredible. Averages 6 rebounds per game at 5'10". He's got 11 rebounds in this game.
And Notre Dame, again, leading the Big East in offensive rebounding and an outstanding effort. Outstanding effort by Torrey Jackson. You know, let's not forget, he's got a pretty long reach for a guy his size as well. Outstanding elevation, but it's really his desire that gets him offensive rebounds. He doesn't mind going in there and mixing it up. And you can see that the Pittsburgh guards, just not accustomed to having an opponent who rebounds like that. They're not even blocking him out. So Jackson can go anywhere he wants to get the rebounds.
Only a 50% free throw shooter. But gets both of those, and it's his second consecutive double-double. He had 17 points, 10 assists against Rutgers. 10 points, 11 rebounds tonight. LaVance Fields will come back into the game now for Pittsburgh. And will likely guard Torrey Jackson.
But more importantly, he's going to make somebody guard him.
And we've got a whistle. I think Jamie Dixon did get a timeout in, so that will leave the Panthers with just one timeout remaining and a lot of time on the clock, 9:35 to go, and a great game here in South Bend. Been a great season in the Big East. How about Connecticut? The Huskies have won 10 in a row. Meanwhile, Louisville playing the best basketball of anybody in the Big East, which has 5 teams in the top 25, the most of any conference in college hoops.
Well, 2 teams putting it all together. Connecticut, you can no longer call them young. They're experienced now. They've kind of found themselves a personality, if you will, and they've learned how to close tight games. And Louisville, the team that everybody expected before the injuries. When the injuries occurred, nobody expected Louisville to live up to that tie for first place with Georgetown, where they were picked preseason. But now they're right there, tied with Georgetown in first place.
Baseball past the length of the floor. And it'll go to Notre Dame under its own basket. Wow, out of a timeout. That's not what Jamie Dixon wanted.
That may be what he wanted based upon the way Notre Dame was guarding, but a little too strong by Sam Young. He had a man open. Just overthrew him.
Len, are you a little concerned with Georgetown right now? Lost at Syracuse over the weekend, struggled on the road at Providence on Monday.
No, I'm not concerned, and I don't think John Thompson III is overly concerned. Yes, they miss Jeff Green. They miss that versatility that he brings to the table. They need a guy that's going to really be able to take over games down the stretch. Roy Hibbert can't do it by himself and certainly hasn't shown the aggressiveness to be able to do that.
Aaron Doty hacked. He'll go back to the line.
But still, going back to Georgetown, this is a tremendously competitive conference. You know, they're still 6-0 at home, 5-3 on the road. You know, they've shown the ability to win close games as well. And, you know, you just can't discount Louisville coming back from the injuries, the improvement of Connecticut, and certainly Notre Dame.
Aaron Doty now 6-7 at the line, 16 points. Here on our Thursday night showcase presented by T. Rowe Price at the Joyce Center, where Notre Dame has won 34 straight games, 15 in a row in the Big East, trailed by 10 on two occasions in the second half. Right now down just two thanks to a 13-4 run. A lot of time left, 9 minutes to go.
Pittsburgh's got to get back to doing what they did to build the lead, playing solid half-court offense, working Dewan Blair on the glass, and obviously going to their go-to guy, Sam Young, third leading scorer in the conference.
15 points for Young, 3 three-pointers for a guy that last year shot 31% from behind the arc, better than 40% this year. Kerrs misses the baseline, Jay on the other end. And LaVance Fields, his second game back after missing 12 straight with a foot injury. The extra passing by Pittsburgh results in an open three, but it's a brick by Fields.
And this is a point in the game for Vance Fields playing relatively significant minutes. He's not in game shape yet. Nice block.
Sam Young so good for the Panthers. Another guy that was under the radar, just like Dewan Blair, but Aaron Doty got a piece of that.
Blair's got to make up his mind. He's going to dunk that.
How about Torrey Jackson again? This time with the handle. 12 points for him.
The little hesitation caused by the fumble actually parted the waters.
'58-'55 Pittsburgh under eight to go. Only one timeout remaining for the Panthers. Dewan Blair can't stuff it home over Kerrs, but a Notre Dame foul. 17 foul on the Irish, and that's four on Kerrs. Torrey Jackson has been the story tonight for Notre Dame, keeping the Irish in the game, down three at home. All right, Scott, meanwhile, Rob Kerrs has picked up his fourth personal foul for Notre Dame. He's their third leading scorer, Len, second leading rebounder of the season.
And it's his versatility that Mike Bray's going to miss for a significant period of time. And this is a guy that can take you outside. He can play well inside. He's a good defender. And now, with Ryan Ayers and Zach Hillisland out there, not nearly the offensive players, more perimeter players, although Hillisland has shown the ability to put the ball on the floor and go to the basket. And again, Blair misses another free throw, which is now makes him 1 of 6. And you talk about building a house. He's got the foundation laid.
Got the second one, 63% foul shooter on the season. And Blair will go to the bench now. 14 points, 12 rebounds for Dewan Blair. Tyrell Biggs into the game. Hit leading by four here in South Bend, where Notre Dame is trying to make it 35 consecutive home wins.
And for the period of time Biggs is out there, he's got to be sure that Aaron Doty doesn't get to the basket and pull down some boards. And if he has to use some fouls to do it, he needs to do it for Pittsburgh.
Hillisland missed an easy one. Benjamin and Young with 15 apiece. Here's LaVance Fields, who has 6 points in the game to go along with 5 assists. Just a second game back after a major foot injury. Rebound by Hillisland. Jackson looking to push the tempo. Got a double-double, points and rebounds tonight. McElarney, an NBA range three. Second three for Kyle McElarney. He leads the Big East in three-point shooting.
That's only his eighth point, but a big one. And off the penetration by Torrey Jackson, drew in all the pit defenders. Whoa, man, drew all the pit defenders in, but on the other end. I mean, LaVance Fields, he had no angle. I don't know how he got that shot, particularly banking it off the glass.
He's got eight. Pittsburgh's lead is back to three. Not a Heron Cody on the low block. The Big East leading scorer and rebounder in conference games. Wanted a foul, but Tim Higgins says no.
Biggs got away with one, even though he might not have made contact. Normally, when you swat down like that, the officials make the call, but Tim Higgins right on top of it again. The Biggs getting his job done on the offensive end. Oh, man.
Offensive foul on Fields. That's his third and the ninth on Pittsburgh. The toughness that Torrey Jackson brings to the table is an incredible asset to this Notre Dame basketball team.
And watch him take it now. He acted a little bit, but, man, he took the full brunt of that shoulder. And LaVance Fields is not a little man. And watch the penetration right here. Torrey Jackson draws everybody in, including Fields, who didn't believe McElarney had that kind of range. But he's a believer now.
McElarney quickly double-teamed as soon as he caught it there, but pulls the trigger and hits nonetheless with Benjamin right in his face. Kyle's mom in attendance from Staten Island. She comes to a lot of the home games. And the Irish now tied with Pittsburgh at 61 with 5.5 to go.
And we said it earlier, a tremendous street shooter.
And the steal, Heron Goody with the stop. Team points now for Heron Goody, and then Young turns it over. This is why they've won 34 in a row here at home.
Well, again, Heron Goody anticipating that as Biggs doesn't come and meet the ball. And again, we talked about Kyle McElarney. Pittsburgh had him in a bottle for most of this game, but an explosive scorer, tremendous streak shooter. When he gets the feeling, he gives it to the rest of his team.
And the crowd definitely a factor on that turnover there by Young. Notre Dame ball with a two-point lead. It's trailed by double figures in the second half in this game. McElarney for another three. Not that time. Hillisland trying to keep it alive, gets called for a foul. That's his third and the eighth on the Irish in the half. Kyle McElarney with some NBA range threes. And speaking of the NBA, continues with a doubleheader tomorrow night on ESPN. First, it's the Cavs and Wizards. Cleveland involved in an 11-player deal with the Bulls and Sonics today, picking up Ben Wallace. Celtics and Suns in the nightcap. Shaq's debut last night for the Suns. Not a successful one for his team, but his numbers not bad in 29 minutes, 15 points, 9 rebounds.
Well, it certainly has changed the complexion of the Phoenix attack. And you know, when he's in the game, Phoenix obviously not running as much, looking to exploit him as much as they can. But with that team, he doesn't have to play an awful lot of minutes because they're very adept at playing with Amari Stoudemire in the middle and playing a 94-foot game.
And in talking with Steve Kerr a couple weeks ago, he feels that this trade that the Suns made is not just for this year, that they think that they can get another year out of Shaq and be a contender next year as well.
Well, they'll be a contender. I'm not so sure that puts them over the top.
Especially with the way the Lakers looked last night, and then you have the Spurs making the deal to get Kurt Thomas and Dallas making the move to get Jason Kidd in the West. Game tied at 63 here. Torrey Jackson cans a three. His first three-point basket of the night. And Jackson now with 15 points. They're going to look at it to see if it indeed was a three. If it feet were behind the arc when he pulled the trigger.
And both coaches using this as a free timeout. Let's take a look right there. Yes, his feet were beyond. Officials, even though it's easy to see right here, the officials not in proper angle and properly called for the replay and the video monitor. That is one of the opportunity for the officials to use the replay monitor, and it's all important for them to get it right, and they did.
Mike Gray's team has won 34 straight here at home, the third longest active home winning streak in college basketball. And if Notre Dame wins tonight, it'll be its 20th win overall this season. The fifth time in 8 years for Mike Gray, be the second coach of the Irish to do that. The other was Digger Phelps. Sam Young fouled as he caught it on Zach Hillisland, who picks up his fourth.
Well, not only is Sam Young the go-to guy, but I think that Pittsburgh now is recognizing a weakness defensively as far as the matchup is concerned. Hillisland, not nearly good enough a defensive player right now against Sam Young to be able to guard him. Young with the ability to beat you outside as well as use screens and get inside. And recognizing that, Rob Kerr is coming in the ballgame right now.
Four fouls for Kerr. Hillisland with four fouls as well. Meanwhile, Sam Young with 16 points. He averages 18. 1-for-2 on that trip, and Pitt is 11 of 18 as a team. They're 14th in the Big East in foul shooting. Notre Dame is first in the conference in free throw shooting.
Well, we know how proficient Notre Dame is offensively now that they've got their three-point shooting going. But here's where Pitt has stayed alive and worked their way through the injury storm that they had throughout the season. And that's on the defensive end, and you can see them digging in right now. Solid man-to-man is what they play. You rarely see a variance from that man.
Notre Dame wins. It'll be a half game behind Louisville and Georgetown for the Big East lead. And will be tied with Connecticut, which plays at Villanova on Saturday. Ryan Ayers with his three gives Notre Dame a five-point lead. First basket of the game for Ayers. Notre Dame by five, trailed by double figures earlier in the half. Brown for the answer, no. In and out. Blair with a rebound. Now Young with the stuff, but he couldn't put it home. He missed his share. Jackson to McElarney.
This could be a 4 or 5 point turnaround if Notre Dame scores here. That should have been an easy two. Young trying to be emphatic, try to quiet the crowd. And may wind up just killing momentum for his team.
Blair with the block on Heron Doty. It will stay Notre Dame basketball with 11 to shoot. Notre Dame leads by five with 3:11 to go. The missed dunk by Young. Boy, we've had some terrific finishes in this series over the years. Will we have another one tonight? Stay tuned. Notre Dame leading Pittsburgh by five with just over 3 minutes to go. And Mike Gray star Luke Heron Goody showing some frustration.
Well, you take a look at the block there. Heron Goody believes he got fouled and obviously said something untoward. And Mike Gray gets in Heron Goody's face and tells him that we don't need you to get a technical foul and get another personal and hurt the team's effort right here. Keep your composure.
Ayers with the offensive rebound again. Heron Goody wanted a call, but a clean block.
And puts his hand over his mouth.
Now he and Tim Higgins have been chatting a lot tonight.
Well, I think it's been a monologue. I think it's been Heron Goody doing the chatting.
Heron Goody maybe anticipating some contact there, but the layup gives Notre Dame a 7-point lead. McElarney with the pass. Under three to go as Notre Dame tries to extend its home winning streak to 35 in a row. Missed free throws and a missed dunk by Young have hurt the Panthers over the last few minutes. Blair with an offensive rebound. He leads the Big East in that category, but he lost the ball afterwards.
Well, that dunk really killed momentum, although, again, Notre Dame had the momentum rolling. You know, this is a team, you talk about intangibles. They just do not believe they're going to lose in this building.
Heron Goody going to work. Contact but no call. And Heron Goody now has 23. And Notre Dame leads by 9 at the 2-minute mark. LaVance Fields 3 not there. Ramon with a rebound. Great play by Jackson defensively. Ayers on the other end is fouled. Benjamin picks up his third personal, 10th on Pitt.
Well, here, Sam Young trying to guard Luke Herangode. Flops, doesn't really get it. And you take a look at a step out by Blair. Steps out too far, doesn't ever get back to his man. A nice delivery by McElarney. And Herangode exploiting the mismatch on Sam Young and the inexperience defensively by DeJuan Blair.
Here's the difference right now between the two teams. Notre Dame, 10 of 11 at the foul line. Pittsburgh, 11 of 18. They're at opposite ends of the spectrum on the season in terms of foul shooting. It's an 11-point Notre Dame lead. They were down by double figures earlier in the half. Pitt needs to make the most of every possession. Young with that ball fake, and this time doesn't miss the layup. And Pitt will call its final timeout. Now, if Notre Dame should hang on to win, that would mean Pittsburgh would fall to 7-6 in the league. But, Len, you think they're in. How many teams from the Big East do you think will get in this year?
Well, I think that they have the possibility of getting 18. Those bottom two, West Virginia and Syracuse, have some work to do. You based upon their RPI, you look at their records. And obviously in conference play, West Virginia one game above 500, Syracuse right there at 500. I believe that that's a part of the factor. Obviously, this tournament selection committee is going to take into consideration all the factors that lead up to the RPI, strength of schedule, etc. But they're also going to look at the last 10, which is why Syracuse and West Virginia have some work to do. And I think that, again, it comes down to Pittsburgh. Obviously, to me, they're in unless the bottom drops out. Right now, a loss here at Notre Dame is not a bad loss for them.
Well, Pittsburgh definitely with some tough games left, but who doesn't have tough games remaining in the Big East Conference, which is as good as any in the league. And Pittsburgh will play Louisville at home, followed by Cincinnati, and then a pair of road games. And they finished the regular season against DePaul. What about Cincinnati, Len?
Well, I was just going to say, they're not a pushover, man. And,
you know, is there any chance if Cincinnati wins 10 or 11 Big East games, even though they had some bad non-league losses, because, you know, the committee looks at the last 10 games and how you did, is there any chance they get in?
Well, they're 13-12 right now. To win 10 or 11 games, that means three more wins, 16-12. I think they'd have to do some damage in the Big East tournament to even weather consideration, but that's a team that has kind of come together once conference play started, and you got to give Mick Cronin an awful lot of credit. Began the season without his best player, went down to an Achilles problem.
Yeah, Mike Williams.
And really had a team that didn't know who their leader was, essentially, and didn't find who their go-to guys were, but they've had a different guy step up every game.
And there was a question for Notre Dame this year as McElarney hits the free throw after the Ronald Ramon foul. People knew Herangode was going to be good, probably not this good. Kyle McElarney was suspended for the second semester last year. After being arrested on marijuana possession, he was allowed to come back to school and has had a terrific year. Torrey Jackson, nobody knew how he would do in his sophomore season. But all those guys have stepped up. And Notre Dame is now a minute and a half away from being 10-3 in the Big East, a half game out of first place. Young with the left again. 9-point Notre Dame lead, closing in on a minute to go. And a Fields foul on Jackson. That's the right guy to foul. Jackson only a 50% free throw shooter.
Well, Luke Herangode has had some frustrations, but most of the evening he's had his way. And again, we talked about the muscle that he can use inside. You look how he throws his body around, throws his bodies into defenders, trying to draw fouls and contact. And there are times when he has no contact whatsoever, and you're almost afraid he's going to miss the shot because that's what he's been expecting. Not a great shooting night, but nevertheless worked hard on the boards, gave his team an inside presence until they were able to find their way beyond the arc. And that's really what turned the tide down the stretch here. Guys like Kyle McElarney and Torrey Jackson knocking down threes.
Jackson one out of two on that trip of the line, so it's a 10-point game. Fields with four personal fouls takes it to the basket.
And we mentioned before, you know, you can't play this kind of game with Notre Dame because they will hit their free throw. 74% leads the conference in free throw percentage.
McElarney back to the line. He's a 79% free throw shooter, is 2 of 2 so far in the game.
I mean, you obviously never want to give up hope, but trying to extend the ball game with a team like Notre Dame is just prolonging the inevitable.
Look at what Notre Dame has done in terms of free throws this year versus their opponents. And they've made more than 200 more free throws than their opponents this year. That's an incredible stat, isn't it?
They've actually made more than their opponents have attempted.
Even more incredible. Fields with the miss. Rebound by Kurz. That might do it as Kurz is fouled.
And Jamie Dixon calls off the troops. No more fouls. But Torrey Jackson, just an outstanding evening. Coming off that 17-point, 8-rebound, 10-assist game against Rutgers. You wonder what he could do for an encore, but he was just everywhere, doing just about everything. And we said at the beginning of the telecast, you got a lot of stars, Heron Doty, Kyle McElhaney. I still believe this young man is the heart of this team. He refuses to lose and does everything he necessarily has to make sure his team doesn't lose. And at 5'10", a double-double with rebound.
Yeah.
How
and
tall are you, Dave?
A little bit taller than 5'10", Len, but
when was the last time you had a double-double?
Well, you got to play, first of all, to have a chance at a double-double.
Come on, I know you were dominant in your day, but think about being among these trees and being able to do the things Torrey Jackson has done for his team.
13 boards, 5 assists to go along with 16 points. And we mentioned that McElhaney was suspended for second semester last year, as Ramon will finish the night with 0 points, 0 for 8 from the field. Jackson was the guy that started as a freshman in the Big East when McElhaney was out. He and McElhaney playing together this year. And a great backcourt duo for Notre Dame, which is going to win its 35th straight home game tonight.
Pittsburgh defense just fell apart here in the second half. You give credit to Notre Dame for knocking down the shots. 52 points is what Notre Dame scored in the second half after being limited to just 30 in the first half.
Pittsburgh will have the basketball as Jackson touched it last. Panthers led by double figures in the second half.
But that barrage, the explosive scoring, Notre Dame will outscore you. 52-35 in the second half. Just a tremendous display of offensive power by the Irish.
Mike Bray's team moves to 10-3 in the conference. Tied for third with Connecticut, a half game behind Georgetown and Louisville, and wins its 35th in a row at home, the third longest home winning streak in college basketball. 82-70 is the final score. Coming up next, the Old Spice High School Showcase as American Christian takes on top-ranked St. Anthony's of New Jersey. Big night for Torrey Jackson, 16 points, 13 rebounds, and a Notre Dame victory. For Len Elmore and our entire ESPN crew, I'm Dave Pasch. Now let's go back to the studio and Scott.